Hello everyone, I'm Khalid. I'm going to talk about SIMRED, which is the chest X-ray triage software that we are building at Semyon. First of all, a little bit about our team. I'm the founder and CEO of the company, and then we have Eugene, who is an algorithm architect, and our advisor is Professor Kurt Kweiser. He's a professor at Berkeley. And also a former CTO of Synopsys. And we have 10 full-time deep learning researchers, 4 consultant radiologists, and 3 consultant medical device sales representatives. So what we are building is basically finding abnormalities in medical images. So an example is if we want to diagnose an abnormality on a chest X-ray, then let's say there are these list of diseases that we can screen, and if it looks like there is a certain type of abnormality, then the software will basically locate those abnormalities, and it would be easier for the radiologist to see it, basically bringing the radiologist's attention to this abnormality. And basically, the radiologist can use the usual CAD software that they use. Only thing that we are adding is this panel, which is basically showing you what are the abnormalities that we are screening and if there is in presence of any of them here. So other than X-rays, we also work on mammogram, CT scan, and MRI, but we are mostly focused on chest X-rays. So I will show results on this chest X-ray studies. So first of all, let me just show you some disease burden, some of the diseases that we can scan using a chest X-ray. So for example, for pulmonary nodule, there are about 0.2 million people affected every year within US, and the burden of this disease is 12 billion in US. Similarly, for airspace disease or pneumonia, around 5 million people are affected, and that burden is $10 billion in US. And for tuberculosis, the worldwide people diagnosed is 10 million, and the disease burden is 12 billion. So this is one example of detecting one disease called cardiomegaly, which is basically increase of size of heart. And the research that we have done, compared to previous methods, our results show 17 percentage point higher accuracy compared to the best results in the literature. Then basically, not only that disease, we detect about 20 or so abnormalities on chest X-ray. Then we talked with radiologists in terms of these different types of abnormalities, what would be most interesting to them for detection? What are the things that are most difficult for them to detect? So some of the three examples that I talked about are those like pulmonary nodule, pneumonia, and tuberculosis. So for pulmonary nodule detection, compared to previous best results, we have about 18 percentage point higher accuracy. For airspace disease detection, we have compared to, if we just apply a single neural net, compared to that, we get about 15% higher accuracy if we optimize the problem. And for tuberculosis detection, compared to the state-of-the-art numbers, we get about 4 or 5 percentage point higher accuracy. And this is already in use in some hospitals. Okay, so the last examples that I gave, those are for abnormality diagnosis. Then there are screening problems as well, where you want to do basically population screening. So for population screening, the problem is to basically, you want the false negatives to be zero. If someone has a disease, you don't want to miss those. Okay, so the question is, how can we achieve those zero false negative? Again, for some of these problems, even if you have high accuracy, that doesn't mean that you would get a zero false negative. So we have basically built a number of like machine learning pipelines, which for some cases can actually give us zero false negative. And we have done that for like a small amount of abnormality with a lot of other abnormalities present. So in those cases, achieving zero false negative rate, we still get like around 30% or so false positive rate. So what that means is that if you have the X-rays of a population and you want to screen it, then basically 66% our software can say that there is not this abnormality that you are screening. So the radiologist can only look at 33% of those X-rays. So that's what we are saving here. So this is a little bit of advertisement. So why you should use us? We have the highest accuracy abnormality detection, lowest cost, and we have worked very hard on system integration, meaning when we go to hospitals, it's very difficult to integrate external software in the pipeline. So we worked very hard so that our software works on any system with any software. So progress so far. So the software has been deployed at six pilot hospitals and diagnosis centers outside US. And we have validated our product with four radiologists. And we are working with two teleradiology companies in USA now. And we are basically exploring FDA approval process at this point. So thank you.
Any questions?
Yes.
Caleb,
Larry.
Excellent presentation.
Thanks.
As we will tell you, I'm a big imaging person. What's the business model in terms of how you generate revenue?
Right.
Maybe it's different in the U.S. versus outside U.S. But.
Right. So I think, I mean, there are three kinds of users that we see. One is teleradiology companies, where the application is basically like finding out what are the X-rays that needs, let's say, quick review, and basically routing them to the right experts. So in those cases, we are looking for licensing our technology to those teleradiology companies. And for hospitals, basically, you can think of almost similar application where the referring doctors can get a screen and then they can decide whether they want to refer it to a radiologist or they are comfortable with the screen result. And the third one is basically independent radiologists who work as teleradiologists or maybe have a small teleradiology for themselves. So for them, basically, it becomes like an advertisement point that not only are we doing like human reading, in addition, we have a screening in place.
Thank
yeah.
You.
Yes.
Can you share something about your training model, like how the source of data, for example, on the samples, and
right.
To train for different type of
right.
Imaging.
Right. Right. So the first question is the source of the data, right? Yeah.
The way you train.
Right. Yeah, the training data. So initially, when we report these numbers, we report numbers on publicly available data where people have already reported numbers so that we can compare one-to-one that how well our program is doing. So after that, like we have a teleradiology service, so we get data from there. And also, we have applied to some hospitals as research projects. So from there as well, now we are getting about a quarter million chest X-rays. So that gives us the data to train these models. And the second question was, sorry. All right. Right. So there are two ways you can detect it. One is at the global level where you just feed an X-ray into the model, and you give a lot of, let's say, examples of tuberculosis, and the model just learns to detect tuberculosis. And once the model is trained, then you can basically use that model to find out in that image what are the areas that are kind of hot spots for it to decide tuberculosis versus something else. So that's something you can find out. And second thing you can do is like using human intuition. So for example, if it is pleural effusion, then you know that the costophrenic angle would be something different than a normal one. So in those cases, you can go into an X-ray and basically find out that angle and calculate that number. If it is anything different than the normal, you can say that this is pleural effusion. And usually, for example, TB is like you would look at a couple of abnormalities, and the combination of those is tuberculosis. So from there, basically, you infer that it looks like there is a high possibility of tuberculosis here. Yes?
Yeah, I was curious, are there competitors to what you're doing? And if so, like, how does your service, what do you distinguish from those competitors?
We don't distinguish. We just report numbers that compared to whatever is known, we show better numbers than those. And basically, I think for these kind of AI technologies, there is a lot of opportunity will open up if we really find out what are the business cases, where it is really useful. I think we're not really competing at this point. It's more about finding use cases. Yes?
For lung cancer, is there any advantage using your product to detect or early diagnose of lung cancer patients where radiologists cannot see from the CT or X-ray?
No, I mean, CT is more accurate than X-rays. The reason why we focused on this is that, first of all, X-rays is something like everyone does a chest X-ray. So it basically gives the physician a first screen. And the second thing is like CT is done mostly in US, but if you go outside of US, like CT is very rare. Like it's only like in some large cities that you would get a CT scan or MRI. But in like rural areas, there is nothing like that. So we were very interested in like first application that we thought of is that we should look at those areas. Although maybe business-wise it doesn't make a lot of sense, but I think that's one of the motivations that why we are doing this.
Right. So just to add to another question, so for X-ray, mm-hmm. for high volume, for example, have the company provide physical checkup for the employees.
Right.
They get $100,000, they get their X-ray, and use your system can
screen it. Yeah.
Screen it.
Right.
Have early diagnosis of lung cancer.
Right.
I
shouldn't say better than human with X-ray because in X-ray it's very difficult to, I mean the signal is not very clear compared to let's say a CT scan. But what it can do is that it can act with a radiologist so that the accuracy of the radiologist is higher than if the radiologist was working alone for lung nodule. But there are other problems. For example, for TB, our numbers already show that those numbers are better than radiologists, human radiologists.
Right.